sure the birds are real impressed, eh? But once you finish showing off, you think you might concentrate on some actual work? Get Celeste in position for a handoff. You need to get the delivery to her. She'll be near the communication tower ahead of you.
Every new day holds a promise. You can waste it or spend it advancing yourself, furthering your prospects and your career. As a future employee of a corporation of your choice, your possibilities are infinite. The key to success lies in unlocking your inner potential through hard work and relentless dedication.
When it comes to making content for things based on your niche or something that you enjoy, you'll inevitably come across parts of it that you don't like. Whether it's the process of making a video or the process of collecting footage, or even just making content for the sake of content, on something that makes you feel dreadful for even wasting time on it. In gaming, I've played a ton of amazing games, but I've also played a ton of games that either disappointed me or games that I just flat out did not like or weren't for me. For me, this is something that I cannot avoid. It comes with the territory of exploring gaming as well as making potential content in the future. But there is one thing that I can control, and that is I decide what to make content for. I decide what content I would like to make, which is why I will never make content for things I genuinely do not enjoy. I think it is a massive waste of time in comparison to making content for something that I actually like. Something that I'm passionate about. Sometimes I am willing to give something a second chance, and it could be for a number of reasons as to why. It could be that I wasn't in the right mood when I first started playing it, maybe I didn't quite understand the core mechanics, or maybe I may have stumbled upon a type of game that I just wasn't used to. One of those games that I gave a second chance is Mirror's Edge Catalyst. The first Mirror's Edge had left such a big impression on me for its unique setting and art style, its focus on parkour movement that made running through the levels a blast along with its amazing soundtrack. It was one of the best games I had played that year and arguably the most unique game DICE has ever done. But the sequel was something that was on the one hand polarizing and still somewhat enjoyable. The huge leap in graphics across the 8 years of its development cycle was quite telling when you look at the powerhouse that is the Frostbite engine, but you also look at the fundamental changes to everything that the sequel had shown, being something of its own entity rather than a sequel to a beloved game. Back in 2019 when I first played it, I had gotten somewhat lost in the incredibly smooth movement, was getting lost everywhere, where to me the game had become somewhat bland in a sense. At least in terms of what you see as you play through it. At the time of its release though, people were expecting something of the same caliber of the first game, only to not quite get what they hoped. The repetitive open world structure, the somewhat lackluster story and less unique art style, it was to some extent a downgrade from the original in some aspects, but also an improvement in others. Its gameplay was far more fluid and smoother, its graphics were better on a technical level, the characters in the story had more development in comparison to the first game, where the characters had little to no changes throughout the story whatsoever, and also this game had a bigger sandbox to explore and run around, compared to the first one, which was more linear, which I will get into a bit later on. It was actually a good game that took a few steps forward and then a few steps back, but it was also a game that didn't do well enough for DICE and EA to expand on the series afterwards. Mirror's Edge Catalyst has been out since 2016 and I haven't seen anything indicating any interest in a sequel game from the companies themselves. So let's have a look at Mirror's Edge Catalyst and see how it holds up now. Mirror's Edge Catalyst may have at one point intended to be a sequel to the first game, but in the long development cycle of this game in particular, as well as the continual improvements to technology and game development, EA and DICE had decided to make the game a semi-reboot, as a reflection of the leaps made over the past 8 years since the first game's release. By semi-reboot, it would mean that it would essentially have the same kind of story but in a setting that is its own, and has nothing to do with the first game. We would have the same character, but not from the same universe. Its structure would also be different. Rather than the linear experience that we would have in Mirror's Edge 1, we would have an open world setting instead, even though the developers insist on it being called a free roaming game. But just for the sake of convenience, I'm going to classified as an open world game for the rest of this video. As I've gotten older in my years of gaming, I've become 50-50 on the idea of open world in games. I've grown to love the open world sandbox structure of games like Terraria, Minecraft, Fallout, Elder Scrolls, Unturned, Mountain Blade, and Kenshi. Games with a more sandbox approach where everything seemed limitless and that you could do whatever you wanted and go just about anywhere without any worry of agency to follow a main story that you don't really care about. But games like Assassin's Creed and Far Cry, I've become disenchanted with over the years. It was fine for the first couple of games like Far Cry 3 and 4, Assassin's Creed 4, Black Flag, and Assassin's Creed 2, but afterwards it became extremely tiresome and would only get worse in the more recent entries of the Assassin's Creed franchise. Lots of time-wasting filler to arbitrarily make the game longer than it actually needs to be. Unless I'm really enjoying the game, I generally avoid these type of games entirely. Mirror's Edge Catalyst to a degree echoes this kind of structure as well, having lots of delivery runs or challenge runs that you can do across the City of Glass as well as getting collectibles, but it's not as mandatory as you might think. In fact, you can ignore the majority of the collectibles and the side content and still get through the main story just fine, which I was relieved to realize early on, because games like Far Cry and especially Assassin's Creed peer pressure you into this cycle of doing content out of the worry that you might be underleveled to face higher leveled enemies, even when you need to do the main story to progress further ahead. In Assassin's Creed Origins, it felt like work. In Odyssey, it was downright miserable because of how much you'd have to do. I've heard that it was even worse in Valhalla, which is why I haven't even touched it. The shift from the linear-based level structure of the first Mirror's Edge to the open-world setting in Catalyst to me felt like a natural progression. Parkour at its core is about freedom and movement, and the nature of open world is that you can move about anywhere you want. For a game like Mirror's Edge, this would be perfect. But at the same time, this game still feels somewhat limiting. There's only so many places that you can traverse, and you can't climb everywhere either, even if it may look like you can. A lot of the times you're even on a guided path, which makes it more linear in effect, even though they tell you early on that the red lit path isn't always the fastest. Even then, most people will end up following it just because they'd be lost without it, due to a lot of the game's setting meshing too well together. It may feel bigger, but where you can actually go is still relatively small, that it's not too far apart from what the first game allowed you to do, which is where the setting comes in. Part of what made Mirror's Edge 1 work so well was its contemporary-based setting that felt like an alternate reality, what it would be like to live in a utopian or dystopian society, where the white-filled city and bright colors lull you into this belief that the city is safe and comfortable, provided that you don't break any rules, that is. Its artistic approach to its graphics is also the reason why it still holds up really well today. But Mirror's Edge Catalyst does the opposite here and decides to go for a more intricate and detailed futuristic setting. It looks pretty, the choice of colors is similar to the first, and for the most part it works. Graphically, it's a gorgeous looking game. Character models and details in the environments hold up so much better here. But at the same time, it doesn't feel as unique or as interesting or as believable. The first game made more sense and was more grounded in its setting given that it was closer to the modern times. In this game, you see lots of weird geometry and flying cars everywhere. It's not necessarily bad, it just doesn't leave the same impression compared to the first game's more minimalistic and unique setting. But in saying that though, the game's setting was probably something that DICE wanted to do in the first place, but didn't have the means to do so with the Unreal 3 engine at the time. But 8 years later, and with the Frostbite engine, they were able to create a more realized version of the setting that they may have wanted to begin with, even to the point of injecting a number of NPCs through the game's open world, making it more lifelike and populated, which is what the first game should have had, but couldn't at the time. Mirror's Edge Catalyst does break the monotony with its main missions though. I think they're just as good as the ones in the first game, where they're still a bit more linear and stand out more because of the specific locales that you end up visiting throughout the story, which ties into the game's story. Like I had said, the game's story is fundamentally the same as the first one. It's set in a dystopian city where the corporations have been taking over and consolidating power in the form of a conglomerate ruled by various families. Over time, there would be a protest, and you, the main character, end up losing your family in the aftermath of a riot, even your sister this time around. Another character, Noah, who's basically Merc, would take you in as a runner. And from that point on, they would be your new family. The view of running in this game is something that's a bit more relaxed in this setting compared to the first one where it was straight up illegal. Faith in this game gets out of prison thanks to someone that she owes a debt to. You begin running around again and go on a gig that stumbles you into something that creates, wait for it, a catalyst of events that shake your own world. Story-wise, it's nothing special, but neither was the first game, to be honest. In saying that though, the characters in this game have a lot more dialogue to work with, and Faith as a character has more lines and even some character growth along the way. She's youthful and sometimes arrogant, but at her core, she's still the same character as the original Faith, who still has genuine concern for those that help her, as well as her fellow runners. If you can get past the somewhat YA vibe of the game's story, then you'll be able to move on to the best part about Mirror's Edge Catalyst, its gameplay. When you boil down to it, Mirror's Edge Catalyst is objectively a better game compared to the first one in terms of the sense of movement, its mechanics, even down to its combat. The first Mirror's Edge was amazing when it worked, but also frustrating when the platforming turns against you and you clip through certain objects leading you to your death. In this game though, it's not as frequent because there's been a lot more polish applied to the existing mechanics, where it really just becomes more of a skill issue rather than a hiccup in the game's code. The game feels far more smoother and fluent compared to the original. Faith runs even faster and has more verticality thanks to the gadgets that she obtains throughout the story. Even with the somewhat limiting open world structure of the game, speedrunners have found more unique methods to tackle the side content and even the main missions. In the open world setting that you traverse, you find more collectibles or take down towers, do side missions, stuff that you can neglect and just focus on the story basically. In fact, I would recommend just doing the story first because when you beat it, you're sent back to the open world and you can play at your leisure, completing everything. Animations here are incredibly smooth. When you pull off a number of jumps and climbs without losing much speed, it almost becomes like therapy, just like the first game. Which is why, on the one hand, I'm glad that they went for more of an open world structure, even though I wish there was more freedom in where to go. You have a gigantic city, and it feels like you're only exploring a block of it. In terms of combat, this game does it so much better. The reason as to why is because it takes out the slow gunplay of the weapons and integrates the hand-to-hand combat along with your ability to move at breakneck speed. The enemy variety is limiting, but they each have their own quirks that you can eventually figure out and manipulate. And the best part is, you're not forced to fight all the time either. Well, almost anyways. But the inclusion of the focus system allows you to ignore bullets and maintain momentum, even to the point of knocking out enemies while you continue running. Now, before anyone starts crying about it, yes, the game does have a skill tree system where you unlock abilities, but you can clear the majority of them before you're even halfway through the game, and you get all the essential movement mechanics only after a few levels anyhow, so it's not as grindy as some other games. Combat is quite fun, and some of the takedowns are pretty brutal, but the main star of the gameplay here is definitely in the movement and the exploration. Mirror's Edge Catalyst is something that admittedly leaves some things to be desired. Some people in the Mirror's Edge community have expressed some disappointment in this game, and those reasons are understandable. But upon revisiting it once more, people, including me, have begun to appreciate what the game did try to do, and was glad to give it a second go, just like I am glad to give it a second go. At the end of the day, it does more things right than it does wrong, with its improved gameplay, its soundtrack that's just as good as the first one, a better developed story, better developed characters, better combat, and even some social features that affect the world that you inhabit, where you create your own challenge runs for other players or challenge theirs. But the limiting open world structure that still feels linear at times and the setting that doesn't feel as unique or as interesting as the first one ultimately does boil down to preferences at the end of the day, but for me, they're cons. It's a shame that it didn't do that well though. I do hope that EA and DICE give the series a second chance just like I did with Catalyst because it was something that was still enjoyable, has one of the best implementations of movement that I've seen so far in these type of games that emphasize fast movement instead of just gunplay. Sometimes you just end up playing a game at the wrong time. Sometimes you just weren't in the right mood. Sometimes revisiting a game gives you a deeper appreciation for it and you realize that hey, this game is actually pretty good overall, that this game was even underrated. Which it is, in my opinion. So yeah, give Mirror's Edge Catalyst a try. Just don't expect it to be like the first game because it's not, and it's not trying to be either. Thank you for watching.